I really think it's important for us and for France that you still have this activity in France, even if you have one in US and all your colleagues here will show that you have all your habits and activities and you have also activities in a lot of countries. But once again, François, very friendly but very official, I want to thank you as well for all that you did, what you do, and what you will do for Andrea and for France. Thank you.
Fantastic to see science that quality. So I think it's a great thing that you the four or five organizers have set. It's an amazing thing, very very important for our community. And I would like to thank once more the speakers who have accepted to come to this event. The organizers who did a marvelous job, and the institutions who sponsor the whole thing, in particular India in the first place, École Normale, the Fondation d'Etica, so and Microsoft. So it's
I guess we can thank our sponsor were first in Ria, so I have to thank my boss. The links also which is a joint lab between INRIA, University Paris 6, Alcatel, and Telecom Paritech. I don't know if that.
Systemix.
And Systemix. Give us some money. Microsoft, through the research center with INRIA, also helped us. And the Fondation Del Luca, thanks to Jean Ménès. These are the main sponsors which made the event possible. And the amazing fact also that I wanted to mention is that when we start to think about this event, we decided not to invite former students of François to be speaker, but only colleagues. And all people that we did invite did accept to come, which I think is an interesting sign of the notoriety and the impact of François in our field. So I'd like to thank François to make this event possible. And, well, I think we should thank François for this part.
I have to say, I can't prevent myself.
It's secret.
A few words, a little bit more personal, because you know, I'm the only among the organizers. I'm the only who is not former PhD student of François. I wish I were, but I'm not. But I should say, François counts for me more than any other professor that I had during my gentleman's life. Enormously my scientific life. I remember very well the marvelous atmosphere in the project he created in 1999. He invited me, this was the beginning of the Jack project at ENS. Brigitte described very well the atmosphere of this. I mean, I can sign what she said. This was a marvelous time for me. You were learning a lot of things, writing papers, eating together, spending all night sometimes trying to meet the deadline. And this time is now over, François is no longer with us. We try to live our own scientific life. Participating in the organizing of the conference for me is it's a very modest way to pay my tribute to François and to express my gratitude. Thank you very much.
I remember, as I said yesterday morning, that the first time I met François, it was 26 and a half years ago. And since then, it's each time when I think about François, when my family think about François, and so many people in Novosibirsk think about François, it's something very warm, very energetic, very active, very friendly, and so it's something good. Yes, somebody who is working all the time, 24 hours a day, 7 days a year, 7 days. Actually, 7 days a week. Yes, 7 days a week. I remember that once I spoke to François in the morning, so I just returned home because we are, it was, let's say, Sunday morning, they're applying for some grant with Doria. He has extremely warm and nice family. And I know his five children. One of them is here. And I think they really took a part of his big heart. I think and I think that François would not work such independently, such as if François, if Beatrice would not help him as much as she can, and even more than she could, I think. And I think it's in general that when I think about François, I think also about it. It's a nice couple, and I would like to say that I would be honored to come and to talk about it 10 years, 20 years, 30 years.
60
years. It's 60 years, So happy birthday, happy health, be healthy.
I would just add a few words. I would like to thank you very much to have organized this for my husband. And I would tell you that so I could get more attention, more attention. And above all, more knowledge of his coming agenda. I can just say that Sergei described very accurately what it is. My husband is very dedicated to his work and his student, but I agree completely with him. It's a sacred mission, and you can never work too much and be too attentionate with your students. That's, I agree with you. So thank you very much.
first to express two strong feelings. First feeling is that I'm proud of being a PhD student of such brilliant scientist as François, member of the Academy of Sciences and winner of several prizes, and you know his career, and really it's, I should say, something unexpected given that I had chosen to do computer science, and that such fame was not available at that time for people of our community. Now it is, and I'm really proud of being a student of François. And the second feeling is my gratitude as a student and then as a scientist of learning the tricks of the trade with François, learning, of course, the rigor of mathematics and writing papers, but also writing, learning how to interact with the industry and try to make our best to make it profit of our knowledge, and try and learn to select the topics, the problems on which we should work. I remember an anecdote, very strong union meeting in which we classified problems in three categories, and we decided commonly to avoid the second one. Neither rewarding for science, neither useful for applications. And with this, I will conclude my speech and really thank François for all this slight
and the English translation. In order to give you a feeling for Bruno's Southwest accent, I will do the English translation with my best Texan accent. Donc oui, comme l'a dit Marc, c'était un plaisir d'organiser cette conférence au bout de François. Donc François nous a plusieurs fois remercié. On peut assurer que c'était un vrai plaisir pour nous et c'était très facile à organiser. Tout le monde a montré beaucoup de bonne volonté et comme l'a dit Marc, tout le monde a dit oui tout de suite quand on les a invités. Donc c'était vraiment pas un travail, au contraire c'était un plaisir d'organiser.
Simple job.
Donc on s'est coordonné avec Bruno, vous avez vu, on s'est coordonné chromatiquement puis on s'est coordonné aussi sur ce qu'on avait envie de dire. Et donc pour Bruno comme pour
English,
moi, François, c'est...
It's okay.
I will do the English for him. pour Bruno comme pour moi, François, c'est bien sûr notre directeur de thèse, mais c'est aussi l'esprit Mistral et l'esprit Sophia. On a essayé de décrire en quelques mots qu'est-ce que ça représentait pour nous ces années Sophia et ces années Mistral.
We will evoke a little bit the time in Sofia, where we both met François, where we collaborate with him the most.
Where's the black girl?
Donc, la première chose, c'est qu'il y avait une forte exigence scientifique dans le projet Mistral. On côtoyait les meilleures personnes du domaine, on travaillait sur le même sujet. Mais la réalité, c'est qu'on ne s'en rendait pas du tout compte. L'atmosphère était tellement détendue, amical, que il n'y avait jamais le stress ou la compétition excessive qui peut aller avec l'excellence scientifique. La réalité, c'est que ce qui était le plus saillant, c'était la liberté absolue que l'on avait lorsque l'on travaillait dans cette équipe et dans ce projet. C'est une liberté sur la façon dont on travaillait, donc on pouvait faire qu'on décidait entre tes heures de partir en milieu de semaine, faire du ski, gréolier, Ariège, parce qu'il y a moins de monde sur les pistes. Pendant la semaine, mais bon, évidemment, je vous rassure, on était des garçons très, très consciencieux, donc on venait travailler le week-end, parce qu'on avait fait ça pendant la semaine. Et c'était aussi une liberté pour choisir nos sujets de recherche. C'était même étonnant à quel point François nous faisait confiance. Comme disait mon capitaine à l'armée, la confiance n'exclut pas le contrôle. François a contrôlé ce qu'on faisait, on avait dû rendre compte de ce sur quoi on travaillait. Et là, il y avait deux cas de figure. On avait réussi, la différence était très subtile, mais on avait réussi à la, elle a décodé avec notre sixième sens d'étudiant consciencieux. Donc le premier cas de figure, c'est celui qui a été expliqué par plusieurs des orateurs pendant ces deux jours, c'était l'œil qui pétille. Là, l'œil qui pétille, on disait « je suis sur la bonne voie ». L'autre cas de figure qui est arrivé, c'était le froncement de sourcils. Alors, ça n'allait jamais beaucoup plus loin, mais le froncement de sourcils, on disait qu'il fallait faire quelque chose, qu'il y avait des boulons à resserrer. La réalité, c'est qu'on n'a jamais su réellement et explicitement ce que signifiait le froncement de sourcils. On se posait encore la question avec Bruno en venant, et peut-être qu'on va l'apprendre ce soir, peut-être qu'on n'a pas envie de savoir ce que signifiait le froncement de sourcils.
C'est too long to translate. Get the answer. François had two physical attitudes with glittering eyes that everybody noticed and the frowning. The frowning had a mysterious meaning yet to be known.
Maybe twice. Maybe no.
Donc comme l'a dit Jean, il y avait cette liberté dans l'équipe Mistral, liberté de travail, mais il y avait aussi une atmosphère un peu familiale, très amicale. Donc il y avait les thésards qui étaient un petit peu les enfants turbulents du projet, qui étaient tous un groupe assez cohérent, tous très amis entre nous. Il y avait Alain, qui était un peu le grand frère, qui était un peu des deux côtés. Il y avait les filles, qui étaient un petit peu la grande sœur ou un peu la maman aussi quand même.
Un bon pour les filles.
Il y avait François qui avait une position un peu plus distante, mais très très bienveillante. On ressentait qu'il avait une attitude très bienveillante de sa part. Et
Translation?
Yes.
So we were funny.
So last word,
le mot de la fin.
Bon, un original one. Bon anniversaire François. Il y a une dernière surprise qu'on va faire sur la terrasse tout à l'heure, si on a le courage pour le faire, donc après le dessert.
Je vais dire un mot sur Sophia quand même, parce que il y a Effie, il y a plusieurs personnes qui ont choisi Sophia, effectivement. Je vais parler en français et puis pas la traduction. Bon, je ferai la traduction, mais je vais parler en français parce que c'est pas plus facile. Il y a Christophe aussi dans les Sophipolitains et puis il y a Jean. Et il y a Sergueï dans les Sophipolitains. Il y a 24. Il y a Ethan. Il y a Takis qui était chercheur. Il y a Jean qui était prof invité. Il y a Bill qui était éditeur. Il y a...
Qui n'est jamais allé à Sophia?
Non, mais surtout, il y a Franck. Franck, un jour, est venu à Sophia. Il m'envoie... il n'y avait pas de mail à l'époque. J'arrive à Sophia et il dit « Oh !» Franck était avec sa famille. Et... évidemment, mais je n'ai pas terminé encore. Je n'ai pas parlé encore d'Alain. Mais donc, Sophia, c'était une expérience merveilleuse pour tout le monde. Je voudrais dire deux choses. C'était très très fortement lié à la personnalité de Pierre et Bernard. Je crois qu'il y a un consensus. La famille était beaucoup plus large que ce qui a été dit. C'était des gens exceptionnels qui avaient créé ce centre. Et il y avait ma belle aussi. J'en ai fait, Amor qui a été longtemps là-bas. Mais c'était un endroit absolument merveilleux. Et Sergueï, l'autre Sergueï.
Il est très peu.
Donc c'était un endroit absolument extraordinaire. C'était un endroit en croissance. C'était un endroit très isolé du reste aussi. On était une sorte d'isolat parce que le reste de l'univers là-bas, il y avait des touristes. La Terre, on travaille de la Terre, mais on a fait à Sophia. C'était des gens qui ont fait des producteurs. Et c'était un des univers à Grasse,
univers complètement isolé par certains côtés, avec des gens de la qualité de Gilles, dans mon esprit, qui était un visionnaire qui voulait des choses à. J'en parlais à l'instant avec un témoin ici. C'était quelqu'un qui voyait les choses à 15 ans. Il se trompait sa vie quasiment. Il voyait, il imaginait les choses, il avait compris l'importance des réseaux IP, il avait compris l'importance de tout un ensemble de domaines, il prenait des décisions, qui étaient les bonnes décisions, que personne ne comprenait, et que les gens comprenaient uniquement 10 ans ou 15 ans. Donc c'est des personnes comme ça qui ont créé ça. Et c'était un endroit en expansion. C'était un endroit avec une atmosphère absolument extraordinaire. Il y a des liens entre les sociétés de Colita, je les prends tous à témoin pour dire que c'était un endroit, pour moi j'ai jamais vu quelque chose comme ça. Ça reste l'archétype de ce qui doit être, de ce qui peut être fait. Avec, c'était des grands moyens tout de même, hein. L'État avait mis des moyens importants, très puissants. Mais c'était pas non plus quelque chose de pharaonique. Il y avait juste les gens qu'il fallait, l'ambiance qu'il fallait. J'espère, je souhaite ardemment que notre nouveau président en est témoin, qu'on va continuer sur cette image vraiment positive. Que ressentaient à la fois, évidemment, les jeunes qui étaient ici pour des thèses, les jeunes chercheurs, et ceux qui dirigeaient des projets. Et je pense que je voudrais juste dire un mot à la mémoire de Gilles. Saluer la force extraordinaire qu'a eu Pierre Bernard pour monter ce village. C'était un endroit qui nous a tous été absolument essentiel. Donc, je pense beaucoup à Gilles.
Elle passait aucune des barres, parce qu'elle maîtrisait pas la partie du séjour. Et Pierre, tu vois, c'est le genre de type à faire ça. C'est le genre de personne à faire ça. Note de gueule. C'est-à-dire que c'est simplement sur ta bonne tête que le truc est passé. Et Pierre, il a compris que si les personnes qui étaient assistantes de projet étaient complètement coupées, restaient sur le point de vue qu'on avait, qu'avaient certaines assistantes de projet, de faire la lettre avec un parfait du subjonctif tous les multiples de 37 du mois, au bout d'un moment, ça ne servait à rien. Alors que d'avoir quelqu'un qui peut aussi aider dans la rédaction d'un projet, qui peut aider dans la rédaction d'un livre, c'est ça qu'il faut. Voilà.
Il y a une Donc moi, je ne te remercierai jamais assez. Merci pour ta note de guerre. Je pense
c'est
que
c'est Pierre
oui.
Bernard. Alors maintenant, je ne lui ai pas dit, il faut lui mettre zéro pour Pierre de Com.
Il y avait des choses qui se sont en fait.
C'est lui qui a fait
ça. Moi, je me rappelle d'être la première assistante. J'ai commencé à travailler avec vous et j'ai
pas maîtrisé l'imparfait du subjonctif.
Je ne l'ai jamais maîtrisé peut-être. Mais je je me rappelle que je t'avais demandé un ordinateur, tu avais dit oui, on avait fait la demande, et on a dit, ah bon, une assistante, une secrétaire, un ordinateur pour ma vie, ah bon, voilà, ça c'est, tu as parlé des visionnaires, il y avait des visionnaires peut-être dans les recherches, mais vous étiez aussi visionnaire dans l'évolution du métier de l'assistante, et moi je ne m'arrêterai jamais de parler de ça, comme aussi quelques années après, j'ai un souvenir, peut-être une bonne quinzaine d'années d'après, tu venais de partir et il y avait les web qui sortaient, et je dis à Philippe, Philippe je voudrais faire des cours pour apprendre à créer des sites. Il m'a dit, je ne sais pas ce que tu veux faire avec, mais vas-y. Regardez, au jour d'aujourd'hui, ça fait partie des activités phares de l'assistante, on ne peut pas les mettre à jour. Voilà, tout ça, c'est grâce à vous. Et moi, je n'arrêterai jamais de les dire, parce que si j'étais avec une autre équipe ou avec d'autres gens, mais je ne serais pas venue aujourd'hui, c'est pour ça que j'ai mis les Sophia. Donc, c'est mon vécu. Et
elle ne maîtrise toujours pas la partie du coup.
Say the extreme modesty of this set of PhD students who organize this event and refrain from speaking in a systematic way. So first, I mean, I've had students for very many years, and they are now throughout the world, in very many different places, in many continents, there are many in the Americas, both North America and South America. Many in Asia, many in Europe, and many in France too. but what I would like to say is there is something very important. I, of course, I'm probably wrong, but I think to remember the details of all our discussions on the blackboard, all our key ideas, the first paper, the defense, the first position for all of them. It's quite amazing, but this is very strong in my mind. And so it led me to think a little bit about, in a more abstract way, about the relationship between the advisor and the PhD student. It's a very, there's a lot of dissymmetry. It's very slippery. So one is supposed to know. And the other to know less, one is supposed to give a topic or a few topics, and the other one to accept and to make this topic his or her. And this dissymmetry is very special, very dangerous, I think. However, in all the cases, apart perhaps a few exceptions, so this worked very well in the end to reach this sort of prefiguration of what is the essence of what you have seen these days. Namely, I mean, collaboration between peers, where, as we often say, the strengths of the collaboration, the power of the collaboration is so much more than the strengths of each component. And reaching that at the end of the thesis is something which I've seen in almost all the cases, and this is a very, very big reward for the advisor, I think. This is even, I would say, perhaps one of the this relationship and this evolution to this peer-to-peer relation with where we contribute to the creation of knowledge, which can be used by others, which is one of the great things of our scientific life. And this is the main advantage of academia over other types of professions. Should you become a politician, work in a big company. I think it's very common to see that the reward is that you have somebody with younger is supposed to know less, and the victory is when this person knows more than you, becomes a researcher more active, more creative, and this type of victory is unique. The fact that this is the essence of academic life, where the reward is this joint creativity and not power. this is a big strength, and this is the main advantage, one of the main advantages of the academic life and the relationship between generations compared to what we see in other fields of industry, or at least what I saw of industry or government. Thank you very much to all the students with whom I had the privilege to work. I'm very honored that they, together with Bartek, who is one of the organizers and has been a colleague of mine, and not at all a PhD student, he studied in Poland, as you all know. Thanks a lot to have organized this, this great event, and to have had the modesty of not even having one of you to speak. Okay, that was the first thing. The second thing I want to be a bit more, to say a few more personal things about my scientific life in first and then my family. Well, I was born, as you know, a Turing theorist of some sort. It was, I think, pretty clear through many of the talks and even perhaps most of the talk of this meeting. I would like to explain how it happened, and as you know, I mean, that when you're young, there are all these bifurcations, and you don't know from when you are this cross point what might happen. So, the key person who convinced me to be to research was mentioned by Brigitte, and is that he passed away, very unfortunately. Heinrich Koresioglu was a student of Wien, the Wien who invented the martingale world. And we heard a lot about martingales, and Armand mentioned martingales, and Wien also in this lecture. So Heinrich was not only a gentleman, but a very, very impressive scientist, very, very good man. Well, I think if I would not have met him, I'm pretty sure that I would perhaps not have done research or decided to go to research. He was really an extremely impressive and strong mathematician and an extremely clear mind and a very good man. I will come to a few things pertaining to him later. So when I decided to go to PhD, he sent me to ILRIA, it was ILRIA or even Laboria at that time. It was a small lab, the head was Lyons, the father. And I started working with Errol Guillembé, my second Turkish father, as Brigitte said the other day. So that was remember very vividly these years. So that's where really, so I was more interested in filtering and ideas like that. And so I learned about queuing stochastic networks. I mean, I was always interested more in the high dimensional objects than the queues themselves. But so at India, I learned first how to develop, very, very interesting books in the field. There were very fantastic books. There was the I liked a lot. I mean, there was the book of Lajos Takács from the 60s. There was the book of Frank, which had in the early 80s, I think, was. And there was Kleinhock was also a hero at that time. That's what led me to be interested in queuing. You've seen the. So my collaborators of these early years were Bill, he was kind enough to allude to that in very great detail. Armand also, we worked on various martingale techniques. And queuing has been sort of ubiquitous. I mean, lately recently with David, for instance, and also in the early years with Guy Fayol in this area. Another thing which was more important that I learned at India, is to have some sort of grip on reality. So, I like mathematics, so it's difficult to hide, but I think as an applied mathematician, so ILRIA taught me one very important thing, which is that, I mean, so think of, I don't know,
mathematical physics. Okay, so there's some physics at one time, so people start understanding electricity and you try to make mathematics of it. And so Inria and Erol particularly had this, understood this very important thing, that the numerical world was evolving extremely fast, and being a king theorist was nice, but being having a real grasp and understanding of the modern physics of computer communication sciences in particular was extremely important. And so I had a very good master's that I understood really, so people studying very concrete protocols. There was this big activity on the token ring, the IBM token ring of time, things like that. And I learned that. And so it was very singular in France, where people in applied math often would essentially be mathematicians and not have this type of, not be exposed to that. So it was very crucial, and I've been trying to be in the arena at the same time of doing some other things, but to work on this or that protocol, to study TCP, to study CDMA, to study carrier sensing and things like that. We have seen many examples of talks of this type in this conference, and I think these lectures that we heard lecture of Jean, that of Daryl, in a sense that of Jean Walrand, and also that of Frank, are very much in this spirit. So physics is changing. These auctions on the web are, even if we don't notice them, they are present everywhere. And so I think it's so important, if you are an applied mathematician, to change your view on what should be mathematized and to develop skills to understand that. Very thankful to Inria, Laboria of that time, to the spirit of Lyons the father, and to the spirit of Erol, who taught me all these things. Then happened something, another bifurcation. I was a young researcher at Inria, and highly cosmopolitan invited me to his place. So I could have a life like that, where there was, say, King theory and this sort of thing, where you go to Symmetric, SIGCOM, Infocom. And I had invited Moshe Zakai. So Armand knows Moshe. He's emeritus, probably in Italian. And so Moshe is a specialist of filtering, nonlinear filtering. And so I was looking at Moshe like a god. Of course, he is, I think, in our domain in terms of scientific achievements. And Moshe was kind enough to ask me, what are you doing? So I told him, I'm a Q-ing theorist. And so Moshe answered, oh, that's an interesting domain. There are lots of flowers, but there is no garden. So I was terrified. I told myself, well, that my aim in life should be to find the garden of all these things, and or that was the garden, and then a garden. That explains the later parts of my scientific interest. So first, I mean, I got in touch for some reason with the East German school. I visited Peter Franken, and I met a young PhD student named Günter Last. this led to contacts with other faculty in East Germany. This German school, I mean, I hope I will do no mistake, but I have somebody to correct me if I do. This part of the people in point processes, in studying cues, like Peter, who was studying, were all descendants of a single man, Dinenko, if I remember well, who was in. And so there was already the influence of the Russian school, one way or another. And so through this contact, we started a small reading group with Jacques Neveu, with Guy Fayol, and with Pierre Renaud. I hope it's here. Yeah, no, perhaps not. Okay. Oh yeah, it's here. And so we were reading this literature, and that was extraordinary. So I told myself, well, I found a garden. That's what this guy is doing. So we discovered the work of Joseph Mecker, this viewpoint on stochastic networks, and the work of Mates, and then the work of Stoyan. So that was great. And so there's been one of my developed. So then we. The understanding of this huge piece of literature led to this book, which Ben Catton did too with Pierre, and that's been a constant interest of mine. That's really when you forget, in a sense, about the specific laws which allow you to calculate and to compute and try to understand the stationary algorithm structures, the Lorentz scheme, which was analyzed too many times, and this has been like the rest active all the time. So I'm working very hard with a former PhD student of mine who is now in Sharif, Mirsalegi, on trying to extend prime calculus. So first I said this is the garden, and we developed very thoroughly that with Sergei. It was alluded to by Ben Capto when we tried to understand the really high-dimensional objects and to cast them into the stationary framework. And so that was one of the great events of my scientific life, to understand the Jackson structure and this monotone separable framework that we came with Sergei. It has been the topic of many of my students. I mean, Mark did his thesis on this Maxwell's framework with heavy tails, and based on their understanding of the structure of this object. Jean also, and Bruno, and so it has been, and Doi, who is not here, is in Korea, in Samsung now. But, okay, so that was one, and I realized that, of course, I mean, that there it is not a garden, not many gardens. There's not the second type of activity, which I believed at one stage, or this is also the garden, is the Maxwell thing that can be mentioned by Venkat. That started with the first discussions were with Jean-Pierre Quadrat. Pierre is an amazing person, quite uncommon, thinking orthogonally to everybody else in the world. He was encouraged by Ben Sousa at the time to get a bit more interested in communication and things like that. And at that time, with Arma, we had worked with synchronization, on synchronization problems with Adam Schwartz also, and trying to understand some primitives in database synchronization and things like that. And so, a few weeks after Quadrat came, they gave him papers, Quadrat came with this idea of understanding the deterministic systems in the class that we looked at. The synchronization was a max, okay? And adding a delay, so he understood very deeply the deterministic case and started developing the theory for deterministic max plus systems, even graphs, as we said. So it was a great thing. And so we started very actively working, that's perhaps one of the second most exciting things in my life is realizing one day that the Linde equation was just a linear recursion in a random environment, and then extending that to higher dimension, that was the work with Zen, and one day realizing that the stability condition is given by a max plus the Lyapunov exponent. So things that you work out, that we have been working out, I mean, for a long time, suddenly you look at them and the structure changes completely and you have a completely different understanding of what these objects are. And that was for me a triumph of mathematics and algebra, to look at things that I had been contemplating for years and years, and suddenly a huge thing shows up instantly. It was a very beautiful experience. Okay, so many students have been working very solely on that. Jean, Marc, of course Bruno on the nonlinear case, later on, for instance. So it's a great thing. It was completely ignored for more than a decade, and but so the we would have been killed certainly should people at that time have used incremental age or number of euros, of millions of euros that we would bring in the European project, something like that. Fortunately, these things did not exist. But as Venkat said, so this was ignored for like 10 years, then it suddenly blossomed, and it's used also in manufacturing, and there are lots of people getting interested in that now. So that's the Max Plus garden. And the last garden, another topic, but no. This is really the Stoyan. So in 88, this famous 88 year, which was mentioned many times, the birth of our last daughter. So I was in East Berlin just before birth. And so that's where I met Sergei. And that's where I heard a couple of talks on the Poisson-Brannoy tessellation, especially in cosmology. And there was a keynote of Lief Stoyan, you might remember it, in East Berlin. And that was an illumination. So I understood that we could also look at the structure of networks of as geometric objects, as functional point processes. And the whole garden that I thought I had found or discovered as a garden, namely the representation of stochastic networks as functional point processes with the stationary gradient framework, I told myself, well, we could do that in higher dimension. I know the technology, I know the palm, I know all these type of tools. And that started the thing which Sergei Zuyev alluded to a bit later. So this has become a very important, because Venkat had a very nice word, consciously, for the later part, because it is the last part of this piece of work. You've seen in Brigitte's chart, there was one name which was twice bigger than any other name, which was the name of the person just sitting in front of me, Bartek. So there was something conscious. When he came, we decided that we would start something much more ambitious, which was to really look at the wireless world and to look at, to find, I mean, something to use the technology of point processes to build this type of garden, to have all the understanding that people had and add to this understanding by finding a way of representing all these problems as functional point processes as well. And so in the same way, when Sergei Zuyev mentioned this morning that the question which we were asked, we formulated by Franz Dekov, we understood as, I'm sitting here, the user, I want to ask the distance to the closest base station and the moments of that. Okay, so it's pure stochastic geometry. And you want the moments of that, so it's a Poisson question, and we got explicit solutions with that. And then with Bartek, in a sense, we asked a similar question. We told ourselves, assume now you have a signal to the closest base station, the interference is created by the other, which are a bit further, what is the Shannon rate given this signal and this interference in the Poisson general geometry? And we have answers to that, but we have answers to, because we have this general viewpoint on this problem on all the large class again of problems, and that has been conscious. So we told ourselves, look, it could be like, we write this in the book, in the 2000 book with Bartek, that our view is that, well, Len Kleinbrock had this idea of convincing people to use QE theory in engineering. And there was the pre-Kleinbrock period where nobody would in engineering, and then there was a post-Kleinbrock period where everybody would. And then let's try the same thing with Poisson point processes for wireless. And that was conscious. I mean, so we tried. And so again, so it was a question of very many years. Sergei Zuyev, Bartek, Charles was one of the key persons. We worked on this stochastic geometry trees, which are very important to me now. And of course, the high dimension problem was mentioned by Venkat. The group with whom I'm interacting in the country in Austin is pretty much centered on that. Jeff also, Jeff Andrews mentioned Gustavo also, and that's the Berkeley connection. And so, so actually, the interest of Takis and Venkat, he mentioned that. There was a group of people interested in this stochastic, in this framework, the first garden, very very early, and so that it allowed us to develop a lot of connections. Okay, so just to show that all these things are one, so they look unrelated, but I mean, they were sort of structured that way and be created that way. So that concludes the part concerning my tribute and the story of my bifurcations, why I did this and that. And the last thing is for my family. It's the true end of my life. And this was a lot of work, too much, too much perhaps. And so, if there is one person to thank, this is my wife Beatrice.
Le verglas envahit le réseau domanial. Mais on est au bureau, les gars, de chez Mesval. Miné par le microbe infinitésimal, ou par quelques vilains virus intestinal, laissant la méduse et tout le corps médical. On est tous au boulot, les gars, de chez Mistral. Ce soir, pour s'amuser, les jeunes filles au bal, souvent émerveillées, notre rythme infernal. Qui fait pâlir d'envie même les moritales. On assure pas mal les gars de chez Mistral. Votre attente est nuisible à votre capitale. Votre petit réseau de pétriers bancal. Si pour communiquer il vous faut un canal, la solution c'est nous les gars de chez Mistral. Au moment du bilan, vous faites le total. Monsieur le Président, Directeur Général. Alors vous voyez bien quand vient le point final, que les meilleurs c'est nous les gars de chez Mistral. Oh, 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 Mistral. Oh.